Hi everyone, this video will discuss the qualitative analysis of group 1 cations, the experiment you will be performing this week. Before I discuss the lab today, I want to first discuss what qualitative analysis is. It's an approach we use to identify specific substances, typically ions, that are present in a mixture. Here's a general flowchart or scheme on how to accomplish the identification. Say you have a sample containing three possible cations, A, B, and C. Your goal is to figure out which of the cations is in your sample. To be able to identify the cations, you must first separate them from each other. This is typically done by adding reagent that will selectively precipitate one of the cations. So in our scheme, reagent X, which precipitates cation C while leaving cations A and B in solution, is that reagent. In this picture, the cloudiness in the test tube is due to the formation of the solid as reagent X is added. Now, once we precipitate one of the cations, we need to separate out the precipitated cation from the soluble ones. This is done through centrifugation, where the sample is spun at high speed to sediment the solid at the bottom of the test tube. Once centrifugation is done, we carefully decant the supernatant, which is the soluble part of the mixture, into a new test tube while leaving the pellet, the solid part of the mixture, in the old test tube. In our scheme, we now have cation C separated from A and B. So that allows us to perform a specific conformation test on cation C. Here we show that cation C forms a yellow precipitate in its conformation test. We must further separate out cations A and B, in this case by adding reagent Y, which will selectively precipitate one of the cations. Then, once we centrifuge to separate the supernatant from the pellet, we can carry out the conformation tests for each ion. The term qualitative analysis is used because we are not testing for the quantity of each ion, merely its presence. Since qualitative analysis requires selective precipitation of specific ions, two main reactions are typically used to change the state of a specific ion. The first is precipitation reactions, which means adding a counter ion that will cause a specific ion to form a precipitate. For example, if we add sulfate ion to barium ion, it will precipitate as barium sulfate. The second reaction that you will see is adding a species that can act as ligands to the ion, causing them to form complex ions which are soluble. For example, adding thiocyanate to iron ion causes it to form a soluble complex ion, iron thiocyanate. As we go through each reaction in a qualitative analysis scheme, you will see that we manipulate ions to go through one of the states, solid or soluble, by using one of these reactions. In analytical chemistry, a well-known scheme to separate cations is given in this flowchart, taken from your lab manual. As you can see, this scheme starts with a large number of cations, which are slowly separated out into various groups of cations, which are then further analyzed. The first step of the separation is the addition of HCl, which will selectively precipitate three cations, silver, lead, and mercury. So these cations are called group 1 cations. Further separation results in groups 2 all the way to 5. This week, you'll be working with group 1 cations, silver, lead, and mercury. Importantly, this is a solo lab, as is true for the next 3 qualitative analysis labs. So make sure you write down carefully the notes from this video so you are prepared to think through your experimental results when you're in the lab. The goal in this lab is to work with a known sample containing all 3 of the group 1 cations. This is called a positive control. In addition, you'll also work with a sample that contains some of the group 1 cations. In this second sample, you will have to identify which cation or cations are present. I've taken the scheme or flowchart from your lab manual and pasted it here to show you all the steps. In the next section, I'll describe each of the steps in the flowchart, why we do them, and what we expect to get when we carry out the steps. Let's start with step 1, which is the addition of 6 molar HCl to a solution that may contain your ions. This is meant to precipitate only the group 1 cations, which is silver, lead, and mercury, and separate them from all the other ions, which will still be soluble. Centrifugation will separate the white precipitate containing the insoluble chloride salt from the solution containing all the other ions. Once we are confident that our sample contained only the group 1 cations, we must separate them out from each other before we can confirm their identities. The first step is by adding water to the precipitate from the previous step and then heating it. When we do this step, only the lead chloride salt will dissolve, while the other two, silver chloride and mercury 1 chloride will remain insoluble. The reason has to do with the Ksp of these salts. As you can see here, the Ksp of lead chloride is the largest of the three salts. Recall from your Le Chatelier's principle lab that the dissolution of these salts are endothermic reactions. This means that if I increase the temperature of the salts, this will result in a right shift, which effectively dissolves the solids. However, since both silver and mercury 1 chlorides have such low Ksps, even at high temperature, their solubilities are still very low, meaning that at high temperature, only lead chloride will dissolve. Note also that by adding water, we're increasing volume, causing the reaction to also shift to the right and increasing solubility. Once you're fairly sure that all the lead chloride have been dissolved, centrifuge to separate it from the still solid mercury 1 and silver chlorides. The next step is to confirm that the lead ion is actually present. To do this, we add chromate ions, which form a yellow precipitate of lead chromate when lead is present. All right, let's move on to the next step, which is to separate the remaining two ions, silver and mercury 1. Here, we will add ammonia, or NH3. For silver, NH3 is a ligand, so its addition results in the formation of a complex ion, AgNH32+, which is soluble. At the same time, NH3 and mercury undergoes a disproportionation reaction, which is a type of oxidation-reduction reaction where one substance, in this case mercury 1, is converted into two substances. In our situation, mercury 1 ion is, in one case, reduced to liquid mercury, and in the other case, it's oxidized into a compound called mercury 2 amido chloride. As shown in the picture, these two compounds appear as a grayish solid mixture because liquid mercury is silvery black and mercuric amido chloride is white. When you see this, it confirms that mercury 1 is present in your original sample. Once you see that the solid mercury mixtures are formed, centrifuge the test tube and decant to separate the soluble silver ion from the solid mercury mixtures. All right, the last step now is to verify that silver ion is indeed present by adding 6 molar nitric acid. The reason is shown in the following set of reactions. First, we know that currently our silver exists as the complex ion, AgNH32+. At the same time, we know that we have chloride ions still floating around in the solution since we haven't taken any step to specifically remove it. We know that chloride and silver can form the precipitate silver chloride, which is white. However, that only happens if silver is in free ion form. So what we have to do is convert the complex ion back to the silver ion and then allowing the silver ion to react with the chloride ion. To do this, we add nitric acid. The proton from this strong acid will react with ammonia, which is a weak base, in a product-favored reaction. Because ammonia is reduced, this equilibrium is forced to shift left to make more ammonia, but at the same time releasing silver as its free ion. The free silver ion can now form a precipitate with chloride, which is the way we identify that silver is present. So that's the conceptual background of the group 1 cation qualitative analysis. Let's now discuss some experimental steps. First, you'll get an unknown sample from your instructor. You'll also make a positive control, or a known sample, which contains all three ions. The purpose of the positive control is really to familiarize yourself with the experimental steps, to see the actual results you're supposed to get, to check the quality of your reagents, and to make sure that the equipment is functioning properly. Running a positive control experiment is typical in all research laboratories. To make it easy for you to spot differences, you want to run your sample, both the positive control and the unknown, side by side. All right, now let's talk about some guidelines for using the centrifuge. First, use medium-sized test tubes. These fit the best in the centrifuge. Check that the test tubes are not cracked on the bottom or the side before you put them in the centrifuge. In addition, make sure each test tube is balanced with another right opposite it in the centrifuge. Unbalanced or cracked test tubes will break at the high-speed spin of the centrifuge. Spin for about a minute to ensure that all your solid is completely sedimented to the bottom of the test tube. You should decant gently so as not to disturb the pellet at the bottom of the tube. If some of the pellet gets carried compared to the tube that is only supposed to have solution, you now have a contaminating ion, which will complicate your observations and may lead you to the wrong conclusion. The most common problem in this analysis is the incomplete separation of lead from the other two ions. This occurs because the lead ion is not completely dissolved. To ensure complete dissolution, the water bath used to heat your ion mixture must be boiling. You have to use your stirring rod to mix so that all the lead is dissolved. Lastly, centrifuge the hot test tube. If you wait till it cools down, your lead will reprecipitate. A washing step is also included in your procedure. Washing is done to remove ions that are not part of group 1. Washing is done as follows. Add 1 milliliter of water into a solid, mix the solid and water with your stirring rod, centrifuge, and discard the supernatant. Repeat as many times as necessary. Alright, lastly I want to discuss the safety and waste disposal instructions. All the ions in this group are known to be biologically toxic. That means you don't want to spill any of it on you or others, as the ions can be absorbed through your skin. Make sure you have gloves at all times during the experiment. In addition, at the end, all solutions should be discarded in the chemical waste container.